We're going to continue our discussion of the revolved loft technique here. I just want to reinforce the criteria that need to happen for the sketch profiles that you draw in order for this loft to work correctly, because if the profiles aren't set up correctly, the loft operation won't work. So we're just going to model out a blob here, just an irregular amorphous object that lends itself well to this technique. So we need to start by drawing our side and top profiles. I'm just going to go ahead on my right plane here and start a sketch using the spline tool. Whoops. There. Okay. Make it a little more irregular. Again, I'm just modeling out a blob basically. So that's our side view, and our top view we'll do on the top plane here. I'm going to start at the origin again, come around like this. I guess this is going to look kind of like a jelly bean or something. Okay, now notice that the two profiles are intersecting at the origin here because they both have spline points on the origin. But back here, they're not going through each other. Now this is one of the things that needs to happen in order for this revolved loft technique to work. So I'm actually going to grab this point here, and I am going to control click on the first spline and add a pierce relationship. This guarantees that this top view spline is intersecting the side view spline, and that is absolutely essential for this technique to work properly. The last thing I'm going to do is I'm just going to add another sketch that defines the center line of this revolved loft operation. This is the line that's going to be right in the middle when we revolve around like this, and it's going to split apart, be used to split apart the two halves of both of these master profiles. So let's call this master side, master top, and center. Whoops. Center. Okay, so now we have to split apart both of these profiles so that the top and bottom and left and right halves can be used independently as profiles for that revolved loft. So let's start at the side profile here. I'm going to start a new sketch on the right plane, and I'm going to select this and convert entities. I'm also going to convert that center line, and that's going to allow me to trim away the bottom half. So I'm going to call this top. Now I'm going to do it again, but I'm going to keep the bottom half. So right plane, new sketch, convert this over, trim away the top. Okay, and we'll call that bottom. Oops. Bottom. Okay. So I'm going to hide my master side profile now, because I've got it covered with the top and bottom. Now we need to split apart the left and right sides of this, of the top-down view. So I'm going to start a sketch on the top plane, convert this over, and convert over our center line again. I'm going to trim away one side. So I'll call this left. And finally, top plane, new sketch, master top, convert that, convert our center line, trim away the other half, and this will be right. One thing I want to note is that the reason I did this center line in a third sketch as opposed to just putting it across either the side view or the top view is because I think there's a bug in SolidWorks where I find that if I put this line into, say, the master top sketch, it will not be able to convert entities on either the top sketch or the side sketch when I try to split off these independent half profiles. It says unable to project sketch onto sketch plane or something like that. It's a baffling error because I'm trying to convert entities onto the right plane from a sketch that's on the right plane, and it won't work. And as far as I can tell, putting that center line in one of these two master profiles contributes to that bug, what I think is a bug. So that's why I've got it as a separate sketch here. So I'm going to hide these two, because I don't need them anymore. I can't suppress any of these, because these four profiles here rely on these sketches, but I can get them out of the way at least. So now we'll go ahead and do our loft. We're going to use our lofted boss base tool, and I need to decide where I'm going to start. I'm just going to start at the top here and go around like this. That decision's up to you. The important thing is that these profiles need to be specified in order. So if I start with the top here, the next one has to be one of these two side profiles. It can't be the bottom one, because we have to go through one side or the other. So I'll go around this way. I'll start with the left. Again, we find that our blue dots are not lining up properly, so I have to move them so that they're on top of each other. So we get the preview there. Next profile has to be bottom. We can't go straight to the other side. So we'll do this. Again, it's chosen the wrong side. I'll move this over. Alright, so we've got half of it. The last profile is this right side. And it got the blue dot right on that time. Okay, so how do we close this up? We can't click on top again. What we do is we go down here and say close loft. And that will close the thing up. Alright, so you can say OK here. And we've got our egg-looking object. Notice that I didn't have to specify start and end constraints, because with a closed loft, it knows that you want a smooth transition between the last profile coming back to the first one. Let's look again at how this feature is defined here, and notice that those start end constraints have gone away, actually. I don't even have that panel here anymore. So one more thing I want to show as a means of exercising additional control over the shape of this revolved loft is a guide curve. So I'm going to cancel out of this, and I'm actually going to go ahead and delete this loft, because we're going to reconstruct it using a guide curve. Alright, so a guide curve is going to allow us to specify additional influence on the geometry as the loft goes around between these profiles. It's very much like the guide curve for a sweep, which we looked at earlier. So in order to do the guide curve, I need a plane that's kind of going through all these. So I'm going to define a plane that's parallel to my front plane by control-clicking out here. And I'm just going to kind of get it in the middle here. And so on this plane, I'm now going to draw a spline. And I'm going to place my spline points down like this. And afterwards, I'm going to go into each one, and as you probably guessed, I need to establish a pierce constraint. So the top spline point, I'm control-clicking the top edge of the top profile, adding my pierce constraint. Because remember, a guide curve has to go through all the profiles that it's affecting. Same thing over here, pierce. Same thing here, pierce. And same thing over here. So typically, after I've established those pierce constraints, and I've got the spline, the guide curve going through all the right points here, then I start shaping it. So, you know, maybe I want to give it a little bulge out at the top like this. I'm even going to go ahead and I'm going to insert a spline point here just to add a little more irregularity. You know, a little dent, like this. I don't try to influence the geometry radically with a guide curve. That's bound to cause errors. But, you know, little things like this little depression in here are what a guide curve is good for. So I'll leave it at this by now, like that. I'm going to call this guide curve. And I'm going to call it guide curve 1 just to remind people that you can have multiple guide curves. I could have put out another plane there and done another guide curve parallel to this whole thing. Because remember, this here is my guide curve. Alright, so let's reconstruct that loft. Again, I'm going to go top, left, fix this, bottom, fix this, right, close loft. And now I'm going to go into the guide curve section here. And I'm going to click on Guide Curve 1. So what that has done This will be easier to see once I exit out of the feature. What that has done is it used that guide curve to affect how the loft material comes through each of those profiles. It affects what happens in the interim between profiles. And you can think of it as a cross-section. It gets hidden by default inside this loft, but if I turn it on, then we can see that basically this guide curve is defining a cross-section of what this blob looks like at this plane, which it's drawn on. So I could easily, you know, say I wanted to further affect it. I could create another plane out here, do another guide curve, and, you know, put several guide curves all along this object. I'm going to stop here for this example, but that's basically how you can use a guide curve to further affect the geometry of a revolved loft, of any loft really, but in this case it's a revolved loft.